Members, we have a quorum. It's the appointed time. Item number one. Since the last meeting, we have received a number of information papers. Altogether, there are five. Well, actually, there are eight. And there is one tabled by Mr. Holden Chow. He asked a number of questions. Let me refresh your memories. These papers are one from the RTHK is a letter. The second one is a letter from Mr. Michael Luk. The third one is a letter sent to Google in relation to the national anthem. And a fourth one is from six members of New People's Party following up on a similar topic. Mr. Jovi Chan sent a letter to the security panel, and the letter has been forwarded to us. These are related to misinformation stored in relation to the national anthem. Mr. Sunny Tan sent us a letter. He is a chairperson of the Hong Kong Productivity Council. He invited us to visit the council. Last year, we visited the council. If we have time, we can have a visit with the CIITP. The deputy chairperson gave us information about additional items in the list of items to be discussed. There is one which is related to digital infrastructure. It is their wish that this will be added to the outstanding item for discussion. Well, in relation to the letter tabled by Mr. Holden Chow, he didn't have time to send it by email. It's about reindustrialization. We need to grasp the idea in a more accurate way because it's not like the old days when people work in factories. Under the Hong Kong Innovation and Technology Blueprint, there will be more information. So this letter is tabled for your information. Item 2. Date of next meeting and items for discussion. Mr. Luk, you have a question to ask. Just now you mentioned my name, and there are a number of members who mention about misinformation. Google, the largest search engine, continue to put incorrect information of the national anthem at the top. How can we make sure that the accurate information is listed on the internet? What arrangements do you have? Will you ask Google to come to us? Will we have a discussion? Now there are new AI software. That might be another platform for misinformation in the future. I am concerned. Well, in fact, you know that I am very concerned about this matter. I have sent a letter to them in my personal capacity without waiting for the panel. As usual, I have not heard anything from them. And as to whether they are in the wrong, I'm sure that we all know. Perhaps you can give me some time. I'll ask the administration what they plan to do. Well, we have powers and privileges. We may follow it up along that avenue. But before we go down that path, perhaps we give time to the administration. We're still waiting for the reply. So I'd like to see what they think. We do need to set the record straight. Yes, of course. Thank you, Mr. Luk. The date of the next meeting is on the 13th of March at 2:30 in room 3. There are two items. One is upgrading of IM Smart to realize single portal for online government services and propose amendments to the Telecommunications Ordinance Cap 106 and relevant guidelines to enhance 5G infrastructure. So in relation to the two items for discussion, do you have any views? If not, these will be the two items for discussion in the next meeting. No. In relation to the duty visit, just now I mentioned about the visit to the Productivity Council. I thank Mr. Tan for his invitation. And as I've said, we visited the Productivity Council and we have learned a lot. I don't know what's new. I hope there is some. Perhaps we can visit the Productivity Council with the Commerce Term Innovation and Technology Industry Panel. I have heard members' views. We have a very good platform in the form of the RTHK. We need to make good use of it to tell a good Hong Kong story and a good China story. It would be a waste if we do not use this platform. I'll ask the CEDB to arrange a visit for us to visit the RTHK. We'll see how busy they are, what their areas of priority are. Well, in relation to youth affairs, international affairs, I'm sure we will learn a thing or two about what they're doing. It will be to our benefit. We can also give them ideas. Well, the ISD, the Information Service Department, is a large department, although it's not under the purview of the CEDB. How can we make sure that public money is properly used? We're not talking about a merge, but we do need to create synergy to create more. I think it's an idea shared by a lot of people. We'll forward our view to the government. Perhaps we can arrange a joint meeting so that we can work together. And that's my report to you. Well, items of suggested for discussion. Just now I have already mentioned about it. It's the digital infrastructure development. So we're done with item 2. Before we move on, we'll see if there are other visits. The president may take us to the Greater Bay Area so that we can learn more about new projects. As you know, I have arranged other visits as well. Well, we can make use of this year to do work of 4 years so that we can expedite our work and we get a higher level of satisfaction. Item 3, Hong Kong Innovation and Technology Development Blueprint. We'll invite the administration to come in to join us. Members who would like to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. And I asked the administration to make use of a PowerPoint presentation to take us through the paper. This is in relation to the Hong Kong Innovation and Technology Development Blueprint. We have Professor Sun Dong and his team. The floor is yours, Professor. Thank you, Chairperson and members. I'm very glad that I have the opportunity to be present here with my team to attend the Information Technology and Broadcasting Panel meeting. First of all, I would give you some information about the INT blueprint. Innovation and technology, INT, is a major drive of our economy. President Xi has made it clear that Hong Kong is to be developed into an international innovation and technology center. He has given us the support, and he also said in the 20th Party Congress report that we need to develop INT system and enhance our capability. And he also talked about strategies using talents and systems and innovation technology to strengthen our country. This blueprint is formulated. It's a system, a comprehensive paper, taking into account different aspects. It's set out major directions, and it also covers possible measures to be included in policy addresses as well as budgets. It says that we have a vision to develop Hong Kong into an international INT center. We have missions. We have four directions. First is to enhance the INT ecosystem and promote new industrialization in Hong Kong. Two, to enlarge the INT talent pool to create Hong Kong impetus for growth. Three, to promote digital economy development and develop Hong Kong into a smart city. Four, to integrate into the overall development of our country, to consolidate our role as bridge connecting to the mainland and the world. There are eight strategies with 16 objectives. There are concrete measures to better coordinate government policies to promote development. First, is to enhance the INT ecosystem and promote development upstream, midstream, and downstream sectors. We need to support the different sectors, and there will be consolidation of our INT strength. We will strengthen support to universities' basic research activities and policies. We will also strengthen and promote from one-to-end transformation of R&D. And we will also promote new energy development and digital development. And the second strategy is to promote technology industry and achieve new industrialization in Hong Kong. We do need reindustrialization. And in the 20th National Congress report, it talks about using new industrialization for modernization. It says that we have to have upgrading and new industrialization, which is driven by information technology using in the internet and technology so that we create new impetus for development for reindustrialization. In this regard, we will support smart production. We will also assist traditional industries. The third strategy is to diversify venture financing channel and support development of startups. We will strengthen our support to startups. We will provide them with financing. We will also create more investment opportunities to attract overseas investments and to promote the development of Hong Kong and GBA in a systematic way. Strategy 4 is to promote INT culture for all and enhance the overall INT atmosphere in the community. In September last year, it's already promoted that popularization of science is to be given priority. We will need make use of knowledge to strengthen our national development. We will make use of science to enhance the general atmosphere for innovation and technology. We will also organize different activities and events, and we will enhance cooperation with district bodies and in order to arouse the interest of the general public. We will encourage the public to participate in mega events of science and technology. And there is also another strategy, which is to enrich INT talent resources. We will make use of different learning stages to nurture INT talent. There will be different measures promoted to enhance education in this way. We will also attract overseas talents to come to Hong Kong. We will also strengthen our efforts to retain them in Hong Kong. And the sixth strategy is to accelerate the development of digital economy and smart city and to enhance citizens' quality of life. We do need to enhance the quality of our development. We need to make use of smart city and digitalization. In terms of the government, we will promote different departments to make use of IM Smart before 2025 to provide one-stop service to the general public. In relation to developing a digital infrastructure, we will enhance the capacity of our data center. In 2020 to 2026, we will greatly enhance the area for our digitals, for our data centers. The seventh strategy is to deepen cooperation with the mainland and better integration into national development. We will promote the Hong Kong Shenzhen River Loop Science Park. We will make use of this to promote capital flow, talent flow, as well as information flow. We hope that the River Loop area will participate in national strategic development. The SAR and the Ministry of Science has set up a working group. We will work with various mainland academies as well as commissions to enhance coordination and cooperation with different government departments in the use of resources, and there will be work plans formulated so that Hong Kong can better integrate into our national development.
Strategy 8 is to leverage Hong Kong's advantages as an international city to foster global INT collaboration. As an important INT hub, we want to assist our country in going global and attracting foreign investment. And we will proactively extend our international network and collaborate with different parts of the world to develop into an INT hub along with the Belt and Road Initiative. And we will strengthen the support provided by R&D efforts overseas to support the development of Hong Kong's INT development. Last month, I visited Beijing and went to the different departments to introduce our new measures and collect views on our blueprint. I would like to thank the central government for their support for Hong Kong's future development in the INT industry so that Hong Kong can integrate into the overall development of our country. We will continue to listen to views regarding the INT blueprint and its implementation measures so that Hong Kong can develop into an international INT center. You can find a blueprint on our website, and the texts have been issued to members. So that's all from me for now. Thank you. Well, time is limited. We have to hand over the room by 4:30. So 4 minutes question and answer. Thank you. So we have 11 members wishing to speak. Mr. Ma Feng Kwok, Mr. Chen Xiu Hong, Mr. Sunny Tan, Mr. LUK Chung-hung, Mr. Tan Fei, Mr. Lee Chun Kern, Ms. Elizabeth Kwok, Mr. Lam Chun Sing, Mr. Chen Kim Po, Mr. Duncan Chiu, and Mr. Dennis Leung. Mr. Ma Feng Kwok, please. Thank you, Chair. In the blueprint, it is mentioned that by 2025, the government will fully adopt IM Smart to provide one-stop government services to the public. Last month, in a guideline issued by the central government, so does this exceed the target of including digital development into the government policy? What are the obstacles in place which hinder the development? Currently, the public can authorize government departments to share their personal data. It is my understanding that the government is looking into the possibility of using IM Smart as a identity verification methods with the Guangdong province. So I would like to ask, how are we going to implement these measures? Thank you, Mr. Ma, for your questions. For the first question, last month we visited Beijing and met with leaders of our country to discuss how Hong Kong can integrate into the overall development of our country's digital development, not only for the IM Smart, where we are discussing how Hong Kong can integrate into our country's development and the development of the GBA. We have also discussed digital development. Now, OGCIO is working hard on it. As for IM Smart, I would like to invite my colleague to tell us more. But for IM Smart, the target is to achieve a one-stop service portal within 3 years. We want to streamline government services provided there, and we want to allow information exchange among government departments. So now we are working on an authorization measure so that members of the public can authorize the government to share their personal information among themselves. As for the discussion with the Guangdong province, now we are conducting some trials. We want to allow this to be part of an identity verification process so that later Hong Kong residents do not need further verification in Guangdong province. Any follow-up? I'm sorry. Yeah, 4 minutes. Well, I had another question just then about the State Department. By 2023, a data bank for the public's health data. So I would like to know, what is the progress? Is it possible for us to enhance the efficiency? Regarding the exchange of information and the use of the information, we are currently liaising with the relevant departments. First, we have to be able to allow the free share of information. Why are we starting with IM Smart? Because we need to first allow information exchange between government departments, so that we can realize a single portal for online government services. This is what you are talking about, how to utilize data to better serve the public. Thank you. Mr. Chen Xiu Hong. Well, in his policy address, the CE has introduced several measures to develop Hong Kong into an INT hub. And in the blueprint from the top level measures introduced, vision and strategic directions have been set. And there were four general directions and eight major strategies. I believe that this blueprint can act as a catalyst for our INT development. So I would like to commend the Secretary for it. Is it possible to establish a five-year action plan and relevant KPIs? How will these follow-up actions, or rather, when will they be completed? And for the INT application, smart R&D, etc., it is very important to consolidate resources for the relevant groups in Hong Kong, such as the Hong Kong Science Park or the Institute of Applied Science. They all have their own positioning, but their role may overlap with each other, as outlined in the blueprint. And since INT development is so important for Hong Kong, is it possible to look into how these institutions or organizations can be consolidated better? How are we going to consolidate resources or utilize resources better? Let's say one platform for overseas liaison. Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. I can assure you that the works laid out in the blueprint are underway. Actually, before it was published, we had already started our efforts. That is why our eight major strategies are targeted. We have started the relevant works already, from attracting foreign investment to popularization of science and integration into our country's development. Works in all of these aspects are underway. And we have internal timetables as well. We hope that in the future, we can, at regular intervals, summarize our progress in the implementation of the four directions and eight strategies. We hope to liaise with members on a regular basis so that we can listen to your valuable comments. This blueprint is the first of its kind. However, we still need to listen to the public's opinion on the implementation of this blueprint, so your comments are very important. As for the consolidation of resources, in the past few years, Hong Kong has been developing well in the INT industry. And these organizations have contributed a lot. In the past few months, we have been in close liaison with these organizations, and one of the major topics of discussion is their respective positioning. Several government laboratories and science parks, etc., they all have different positioning. So we need to maintain close liaison with them, such as the Hong Kong Science Park, Cyberport, etc. These major organizations, we hope that they will have a consistent development targets as those of the government. And we will continue to be in close liaison with them.
Mr. Sunny Tang, first of all, I'd like to thank the Secretary for incorporating the INT blueprint into traditional industries to assist them to achieve further development. This has answered our our requests and our expectations for quite a long time. With this INT blueprint in place, we think that we do need individual blueprints for industries as well as strategic directions. We hope that the government will support us. Apart from what the Secretary said, that in relation to resources given to these research institutes, perhaps the government should look at allocating a similar amount of resources to traditional industries to dovetail our development. Let me give you an example. Say, for example, fur and knitwear manufacturing is highly automated because they would like to set up their base in Hong Kong to get preferential treatment. And for some other industries, say for example, the process of electroplating of watches and clocks, they would like to come back to Hong Kong to enjoy better trade terms. So there are a number of these traditional industries that would like to come back to Hong Kong. In relation to new industrialization, can you give us any update? Secretary, thank you, Mr. Tan, for his questions. In relation to the blueprint setting out developmental direction of Hong Kong, we need support of different areas. Resources is important. How do we see this? We need to make use of existing resources. Just now, you mentioned about upgrading and transformation of traditional industries. In relation to reindustrialization, we are able to provide $15 million for each enterprise. And you can also apply for talents and subsidies under the talent hub. As I've said, that we would like to attract traditional industries to come back to Hong Kong. When we promote the idea of new industrialization, there are two directions. The first is new development direction, and the second one is by making use of transformation and upgrading, we will help traditional industries. For the next step, the government would like to increase our funding as if possible. As far as I know, that the government, regardless of difficulties, they would like to provide more help. Next week, there will be the budget. You'll hear more about it. The government is sincere in promoting the development in innovation and technology. Mr. Michael Luk, he's not here. Mr. Lee Chen Kong, thank you. I'm happy to see this blueprint. Just now, the Secretary said that it has outlined planning for Hong Kong in the coming 5 to 10 years. Over the years, Hong Kong is in dire need of this blueprint. We need to catch up because we've been lagging behind, especially in innovation and technology areas. Well, we want to develop our traditional industries to industrialization 4.0. It may not have been mentioned in the paper, but it is important. We can select best aspects, best technologies used on the mainland. We introduce these technologies into Hong Kong and then use Hong Kong as a springboard to launch them into the international community. What about nurturing talents of different skill levels, especially elementary skill manpower, so that they can help in the development of the northern metropolis? We are part of the GBA. We can make use of talents of different skills levels to help us. the second area. Well, as I said, the Hong Kong is part of the GBA. There are a lot of policies on the mainland. It's a general relaxation and opening up, but there are still some barriers in smaller areas. Are there any ways for Hong Kong enterprises to gain first footing, to enjoy forerunner advantage? Just now, you mentioned about new energy in your presentation. That itself is an important area of our country. It's specified as a strategic area. Can Hong Kong be used as an exemplary area in the use of new energy, say, for example, hydrogen fuel, methane, so that we can make use of Hong Kong as a launch pad for these new forms of energy? I will give you a succinct answer. First, nurturing of talents of different skill levels. I have spoken to a lot of leaders in SME associations in this area. Our bureau has increased a lot of resources. We have set up different initiatives, and these initiatives are very well received. We have a $600,000 or $1 million available. The next step, we will look into whether to continue our support for these initiatives. We think that we will take into account the unique characteristics of our industries before we map out plans for manpower training. We are actually working on planning. We know that we have only covered 15% of what we would like to do, and there is a shortfall. The second question is how to remove barriers in smaller areas. The government has set up a steering committee for the integration into national development. They will work on measures to help Hong Kong enterprises to gain entry into the mainland market. Well, we want to help Hong Kong enterprises to set up business and to develop in the Greater Bay Area. We are in discussion with mainland authorities. The other area is new energy. You talk about hydrogen fuel. We have actually helped the setting up of a new energy company. There are some good enterprises related to new energy. Of course, for these enterprises, the government will give them full support. Mr. Michael Luk, thank you. Of course, the blueprint looks good. We're more concerned about implementation. Over the weekend, the FTU led a delegation to visit the Shenzhen side of the River Loop and Nansha of Shenzhen City. We see that in terms of INT development, they are going at full steam. They have buildings, they have enterprises moving in, they have supporting facilities put in place to enable cooperation of the academic and the government. Well, in Hong Kong, we have wonderful hiking trails, but when it comes to INT, we seriously lag behind. There are about 80 hectares of land. We have already given them funding of about $30 billion in the Hong Kong Shenzhen Science Park. Construction is yet to be completed. We don't know how much it will cost in the end. The original plan is for completion to be in place in 2024, but we don't know for sure now. what I learned from the mainland is that, well, they need a capable government for good operation of the market. Of course, the government can't possibly just put everything in place, construct everything, and just ask enterprises to move into them, because they will not be able to break even. It would be a good thing if they can recoup management fees. How do you encourage companies in the private sector or state enterprises to make use of land in Hong Kong? What about we give them land for them to take charge of the construction and start businesses? In this way, there will be good opportunities created. If you let the private sector to do it, I'm sure that will result in higher efficiency and lower cost. So is it the case that the government will invite private enterprises or state enterprises to take up my suggestion? Thank you. And I thank the member for his interest in this topic in relation to the River Loop, because of legacy, because of some of issues that was of the past, and some of the land of the River Loop is used as a quarantine center. Well, but there are areas that are developing rather quickly. What I'm happy to say is that we have a timetable for the River Loop to see its original planned purpose being achieved. At the end of 2023, the River Loop will release some sites to solicit businesses. We hope that at the beginning of 2024, there will be land released for construction. We thought there will be 67 blocks. The plan will still go ahead as scheduled in relation to the construction of these buildings. In relation to land use, well, we need, as you said, that we will need the cooperation of the community and the private sector. For Science Park, we put the buildings in place and ask enterprises to come in. In the River Loop, we want to make use of the mainland approach. There will be some large-scale R&D institutes that they're interested. We will go along this way. But there are details that needs to be ironed out after negotiation. Please, don't find us annoying if we come to talk to you. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Kwok. Of course, we're happy to see the blueprint being promulgated. This blueprint is crucial to the development of INT in Hong Kong. And I also see some novel ideas and new approaches. To the INT sector, the confidence has been boosted. I would like to raise some points for the consideration of the administration. First, insufficient manpower. We know that the world over is competing for manpower, and there are a lot of talents that have made use of our different top talent plans to come to Hong Kong, but we don't know how many of them belong to the INT sector. We also need leaders, apart from the foot soldiers. For the different sectors, they said they don't have sufficient INT manpower working for them. What about student intake of training institutes? Can you give us an idea? What plans do you have to train local INT talent and to attract overseas ones to come to Hong Kong. There is a grand vision set out in the blueprint, but we don't know who is to make that happen. That's where we're concerned. And in the 20th National Congress report, they talked about the different links and elements. We have ITIB, we have the Education Bureau. And I think regarding competing for talents, it's under the purview of the Labour and Welfare Bureau. So when it comes to competing for talents, what are your plans? First, how do you train them at a young age? And how do you ensure that we have talents of different levels to meet our demand? How do you train high-quality students to make sure that there is sufficient manpower to meet our needs? How do you attract INT talents to come to Hong Kong to start businesses or to work here? Can I hear some answers?
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Kwan, for your questions. Many people have asked me similar questions. First, regarding education for INT talent, you said that it is under the purview of three different bureaus. But even though three different bureaus are responsible for this area, but we are still one government, so we will collaborate with each other. As for teaching and learning, we are working together with the EDB. And for STEAM students in university, we would like to see an increase of 35%. And we are also increasing the number of research students in universities. So we want to raise the percentage from 70 to 100. And the number will be increased twofold. And we are also looking into how we can step up INT education, including teacher training, etc. We want to see if this can be done through university admission exam. We want to build a complete talent pool for the INT industry. As for works regarding competing for talent, yes, it is mainly under LWB. When we are recruiting enterprises to Hong Kong, talents is a major factor. We encourage overseas talent to come to Hong Kong, and with top level or highly skilled talent, with them comes workers of other skill levels as well. And we will need good infrastructure. If we have well-developed infrastructure, then talents will naturally come to Hong Kong. If we have good digital infrastructure, then talents relating to this will come to Hong Kong as well. And if we are able to recruit Dragon Head enterprises to come to Hong Kong, it will also attract SMEs. So at the end of the day, it is about whether or not we have constructed a good ecosystem in Hong Kong. As for nurturing local talents, I would like to know, in secondary schools, how many students are taking physics, bio, and chemistry? I've been told by university teachers and professors that even though secondary students are taking these subjects, but they lack the most basic knowledge. So I would like to know, even though there are more research positions opening in university, it doesn't mean that they can be filled by Hong Kong students. Well, to my understanding, the number is in the single digit. Well, perhaps the EDB can provide further information. Thank you. Next, Mr. Lam Chun-sing. But I agree with the other members on issues relating to talent for newer industries or INT industries. Other than highly skilled workers, we also need workers with other skill levels. Traditional industries may be in decline, and by upgrading and transforming these industries, they can become something new. And this is related to vocational and professional training. I hope that this can be done in a more comprehensive manner, which covers different skill levels. EDB has transformed some of its diploma program. I believe that these elements can be added to higher diplomas and applied degree programs as well. This can be done for newer industries and INT industries. I hope that you can work with EDB in this regard, so that more talents and more workers with different skill levels can be provided. It is mentioned in the paper that the government has identified some newer industries for development, such as biotech, AI, advanced manufacturing, or new energy. An international biotech expo was organized some time ago. Is it possible to introduce manufacturing line for new energy transport? Well, over a decade ago, e-vehicles, the possibility of manufacturing e-vehicles was explored. Back then, we didn't go for it, but this time round, is it possible for us to look into it? Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Lam, for your question. I agree with your suggestions. We will, for certain, work with the EDB to nurture local talents for the INT industry. As for the newer industry, well, in his first policy address, it was mentioned for the first time that we need to have our own industries. And for the development areas, detailed descriptions were given. As for the relevant infrastructure, well, we have the Common Investment Fund, INT Fund, etc. There are $6.2 billion of funding. And we have also introduced a series of measures to compete for talents. And on our previous basis, we have also enhanced measures on nurturing talents. I won't go through them one by one. One thing that I agree very much is that Hong Kong should not miss another opportunity in development. In the past half a year or so, we have worked very hard in identifying new industries, such as new energy transport. Like you said, we had a few factors to consider. Firstly, which one can assist an improvement of Hong Kong's GDP? And second, we would like to provide opportunity for employment for our young people. So we want to, based on Hong Kong's own strengths, develop industries where Hong Kong can become industry leader. We have to consider each industry's ecosystem, and each industry has a different development direction. We hope that in the near future, we can work closely together. Next one, Mr. Chan Kim Po. where there were 4 directions and 8 strategies in the blueprint and 16 objectives. And this is a very important piece of paper or piece of document for Hong Kong's INT development. Well, how Hong Kong's old or traditional industries can be assisted to transform. I believe that industrialization is important for development. We need to realize R&D results to commercial products in order for it to become a success. Regarding reindustrialization, I would like to know whether there will be any KPIs so that we can supervise the progress. Second, facilitating cross-border convenience, especially measures regarding cross-border INT talents. Well, there are a lot of INT talents in Shenzhen, and they can fill the labor gap in Hong Kong. Since we don't have enough talents in this area, so I would like to know what are some concrete implementation measures. Well, for the first question, I would like to invite my colleague to answer the questions, and I'll add to it if it is necessary. Thank you for your questions. Regarding new industrialization to enhance efforts in IoT, AI, big data, etc., other than strategic industries, we also need to upgrade and transform traditional industries. We have a few measures in place. But there will be a commissioner for industry to coordinate and supervise measures in this regard. As for infrastructure, we would like to build a second industrial center. We encourage enterprises to apply for funding to set up smart manufacturing line. The program was rolled out in July 2020 for the assessment committee. 31 applications have been endorsed for this funding scheme. It is a matching scheme. So for each dollar from the government, there will be 2 from the enterprises. The upper limit is 1,500. For the 31 cases endorsed, they are from many different industries, and many of them are traditional industries as well. And $270 million have gone in, involving over 50 smart manufacturing lines. So from July 2020 to now, regarding reindustrialization or new industrialization, skills have been enhanced and responses have been positive. Together with the Productivity Council, we will see how we can further assist industries in upgrading their skills level. Just then we talk about the watchmaking industry. I'll give you an extra minute. Just then, regarding the talent flow within the GBA. Well, now we are planning for an office for this exact purpose, so they can provide support for talents coming to Hong Kong. We will be asking for the funding required from the Finance Committee to establish this office. And now a platform has been set up online to provide a one-stop electronic services for overseas talents. And I will give you an update as soon as we have any progress. Because of the time limit, I cannot allow a second round. We have two more members wishing to speak. Mr. Duncan Chiu.
Well, as the chairperson mentioned, I have withdrew an item up for discussion. And I'm glad to see that even though I have withdrawn that proposal, we see this blueprint. I have on a number of occasions openly commended this blueprint and the new industrialization. The letter from Mr. Holden Chow asked for elaboration of new industrialization because we need to be able to get an accurate understanding so that we can be free from the straitjacket of re-industrialization. I have met with government officials, I've met with the secretary in relation to the blueprint and the idea of new industrialization. It seems that people are not very clear about that. A lot of mainland enterprises, not just overseas ones, would like to come to Hong Kong. So I hope that you will do more work in the promotion in the mainland market. And I also have a suggestion to make, and I've also submitted the same to the budget, is in relation to digital infrastructure. In relation to digital infrastructure, well, it's an important area for the government to be involved. It is conducive to Hong Kong's image, to show them our determination to develop ourselves into an INT center. I think it is the duty of the government to put in resources on digital infrastructure. We don't even have a T4 data center. Perhaps we can make use of the Northern Metropolis, the River Loop. I think that is important to the image of Hong Kong for us to have this important data center. And there's also the supercomputing center. We need the government to seriously consider these proposals. I hope that my suggestions will be taken into consideration so that we can have a discussion here. When you talk about new industrialization, of course, we will step up our promotion and our explanation. In relation to digital infrastructure, I fully subscribe with the members' views. We have already recorded all your previous views. For Hong Kong to develop a digital economy, of course, we need digital infrastructure. Apart from the data center, and there is this center that you mentioned in relation to the computing center, we will consider them and we will get back to you afterwards. Well, I hope that it's just like the blueprint before is listed as a discussion item. I will be able to see government paper. Mr. Dennis Leung, without a blueprint, we don't know how we can do it. But with a blueprint, now we know the path we are going to take. In relation to the fourth strategy, it talks about to promote INT culture for all and enhance the overall INT atmosphere in the community. I am glad to see that the government has responded to my aspiration. Between 2019 and 2020, there was a report from the LegCo where there are three PISA items, science, reading, and mathematics. In 2006, science, we ranked second out of 57 places, and in 2008, out of 79, we ranked 9. It shows that we are dropping in quality compared to other places. So in relation to DSE, students may take different combinations. And in 2012, The number of students taking three science subjects, 9.4 2019, has dropped to 6.8%. Two science subjects, 2012, 46.5, 2019, 41.1%. One science subject, 2012, 45.1%, 2019, is 52.1%. So over the 7 years, there are less and less students taking science subjects. For the three science subjects, physics, biology, and chemistry, that accounts for less than 1%, only 0.69%. If that is the case, and for Hong Kong to develop science, it is impossible. I may be from the labor sector. I'm also from the education sector. I myself and Mr. Duncan Chiu have met with a number of heads of primary and secondary schools. We hope that there will be science popularization in these schools. For this blueprint, I think it should be cross-bureau. There should be new directions for the objective to be achieved. We've been talking about this for one whole year, and we're now in February. If you want to change the curricula, then you have to do it in July and August. Otherwise, you have to wait for another year. If we wait any longer, how can we train our local manpower? We can't just rely on overseas talents. So we do need change of policy on science popularization in primary and secondary school education. Secretary, thank you. And I thank Mr. Leung for his insightful comments. And I fully subscribe to his views. The development of innovation and technology, of course, popularization of science is very important. September last year, the central authority has put popularization of science into a very important position, because with that, then the overall quality of the population will be enhanced. To be honest, we have not done enough in this regard in Hong Kong. So out of the 8 strategies in the blueprint, there is one dedicated to enhancing the IT culture and atmosphere in the community. Of course, we will closely liaise with the Education Bureau on education. We have seriously overrun in this item. And I see that there is great expectations from members in this regard. We have a roadmap. Well, you need to maybe put in more work to achieve your KPI. Mr. Holden Chow has tabled a letter. Perhaps you take it with you, Secretary. What is about the new term, new industrialization? Thank you. Item 4, work of the Create Hong Kong and the Hong Kong Design Center. I believe the members are very interested in this item. Well, in the evening on the 8th of February, the Secretariat received papers from the administration, and it was given to members on the 9th. I'd like to remind the administration that you have to give us at least 5 clear days to prepare for the documents you have given us. Well, we have done 4 years of work within 1 year. So it would be good if you give us more time to prepare. I'll now invite the administration to come in. They will make use of a PowerPoint presentation to take us through the paper. Secretary, welcome. Welcome, Mr. Yeung, the Secretary, and his team. He'll be talking to us about the progress of work of Create Hong Kong and Hong Kong Design Center. I know that you are aware of that. Time is tight. As I said, that you gave us the paper on the 8th, and the paper was issued to members on the 9th. Next time, please give us more time to prepare. And I'll give the floor to the secretary. You give us a PowerPoint presentation. I apologize. The paper did not reach you until rather late, but we'll try to make up for that next time. We're in the 14th five-year plan. We have the government. We have the central authority support to turn Hong Kong into a cultural center, and we will continue to enhance our infrastructure. We will continue to foster a better environment. In a number of creative industries, we have an edge. And these are new drive for economic development in Hong Kong. According to 2020 statistics, there are about 30,000 enterprises in these industries employing about 360,000 people. Most of these are popular industries for the youngsters. In 2020, we have an added value of $59.5 billion, which accounts for about 2.3% of our GDP. A film is an important soft power. We have the Film Development Fund to help our talents to explore markets. Since 2005, there are about 90 projects funded by this fund. We have used over 90 new directors and producers. We have received a large number of awards. In processing applications, we will respect the originality of these projects. We take into account the quality of the proposal, the budget, net income, and other elements. We will also take into account national security law. If there is any contravention of the national security law, we will not give them funding, and the case will be dealt with seriously. And these projects does not represent the government's views. In 2009, we have set up the CSI, the Creative Create Smart Initiatives. We have funded about 650 projects. We have successfully groomed talents, expanded markets, and fostered the right environment. Under the CSI, there will be a new initiative, there will be a new direction set up, which is to promote a cross-sector, cross-genre collaboration to inject a new drive. These includes cooperation with the animation industry, tourism industry, and cross-genre film genre industry. We will also make use of a promotion campaign to develop overseas and mainland market. We have initiatives to support production, co-production of variety shows to showcase our culture to different markets. We will also fund co-production of films in other Asian countries. This will help Hong Kong's films go global. We will take into account the need for further injection into the initiatives. I will now defer to Head of Create Hong Kong, Mr. Victor Chen, and then I will defer to Dr. Joseph Wong, the executive director of the Hong Kong Design Center. Create Hong Kong was set up in 2009 to support the development of our 8 creative industries. We have 2 initiatives and funds. We have the Create Smart Initiative, CSI. As you can see that in 2021 and 2022, over 18 months, we have increased our funding support. We allocate about $300 million a year. We have our major strategies. They are to nurture talent and to facilitate startup, to explore market, and to foster creative atmospheres. We have graduate internship program to assist youngsters to join the trade. We also have the animation support program. It benefits over 200 companies. We have received orders from major companies. We have microfilm production support scheme, music. That is in relation to the production of music videos. There has been 10 editions. There are also some cross-sectoral projects. That is the digital advertising startups come publishing promotion support scheme. There has been 3 editions so far. We have helped the advertising sector to gain new experience. There are also 3 editions of a game enhancement and promotion scheme. Well, for each edition, there are about 12 gaming companies. They get about $400,000 or $500,000. And they will get another $100,000 for publicity. We have Make Music Work. And there has been 2 editions. In each edition, there are 36 lyricists, arrangers, and they are budding artists. We also have Next Writer Publication funding scheme. Well, we have drawn reference from the first feature film. We have 3 editions in this regard.
And this is a new program, Hong Kong Comics Development and Promotion Support Scheme. They received 200,000 production fee and 40,000 in promotion costs. And we have 15 comic startups from this program. And they have also promoted their work to Thailand. And another innovative program, together with the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, we are utilizing AI in fashion design. So in the first edition here, we taught fashion designers to design with AI. We can develop industry in relation to fashion and AI. Second, to explore markets, urbanism and architecture exhibition for excellence. It is an event for the celebration of the 20th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to the motherland. And it has toured to Beijing and Hangzhou. And we have also brought in some indie bands to perform in Guangzhou, Shenzhen, and Zhuhai. As for Smart eBook Hub Publishing 3.0, using AI, we translate Chinese books into English books and to produce audiobooks as well. We want to develop a eBook hub so that we can bring Hong Kong works and even works from the mainland to international market. And we have also participated in the Tokyo Game Show, which was a success. For Paris Fashion Week, we had participating in the Paris Fashion Week for over 10 years. And even during the pandemic, we went to Paris in person to showcase the fashion designs. And we also have some activities to promote local brands, cross-sectoral collaboration between local brands and industrial designs. So for this scheme here, there are 5 sets of designers collaborating with 6 Hong Kong brands. Here you can see some thermal bottles with magnets attached to the bottles so that the cap will stay with the bottles. And for the second picture there, it shows designs for lamp shades. Another innovative program is called Fabrics Digital Fashion. There were 12 local fashion design units to design fashion digitally. And with the clothing and accessory items, they were put up for sale on some digital fashion markets. And we find that Hong Kong's development in this regard is comparable to that in Europe and in the Americas. And on fostering a creative atmosphere here, just to post 2022. It is a cross-sectoral event with over 70 designers. As for the Hong Kong Publishing Biennial, we have three editions already. And we celebrate the achievements of Hong Kong publishers with over 300 award recipients. Here, the Avenue of Comic Stars, we had three faces with over 100 comic artists participating. Here, center stage, we are collaborating with the Arts Development Council. Oh, sorry, the Trades Development Council. This is one step ahead of the Hong Kong Fashion Week. We invite local and overseas designer to join. Also, the tour. We have been supporting this for many years. It is part of the Business of Design Week. It is held in PMQ. There are over 80 designers. We also have the Film Development Fund. You can see that we have sped up approval process. In the past 18 months, we have approved $500 million. So that is some $150 million. Other than nurturing talent and enhancing local production, expanding markets, we want to focus on building audience as well. We want to bring the audience back to cinemas. On nurturing of talent, we have collaborated with some professional bodies. There is a masterclass in film directions. We have three editions already, and many works were outstanding and broadcast on RTHK. We also have a first feature film initiative for film talents who are producing their first feature film. Through this program, they are able to receive support from experienced production teams with great box office result. The Film Production Financing Scheme, 40% financing at the maximum. Well, lately, a very popular film, a box office success, A Guilty Conscience. We have 40% share in this production. And we also have some other major events, such as the Hong Kong Film Awards and the Asian Film Awards. For the Hong Kong International Film Festival, we have been doing it for over four decades, making waves, navigators of Hong Kong cinemas, and Love Your Life Film Festival. We are collaborating with schools, bringing students to cinemas or to town halls to show films with the theme of Love Your Life. And we also have some sharing sessions. For the GBA development, in the past 2 years, we have been doing exhibitions in the GBA and showing our films there. Through architecture, fashion show, book show, etc., we have showcased the design and creative power of Hong Kong. For the Belt and Road Initiative, during the pandemic, we were able to exhibit in Thailand, in Central World, for the Hong Kong Art Toy Story Exhibition. The response has been very positive. We also participated in the Korean Creative Advertising Festival and the Venice Biennial International Architecture Exhibition. We are encouraging collaboration in the Asia region. In the 2022 policy address, under the Create Smart Initiative, other than the three existing strategic areas, we would like to include another, that is to promote cross-sectoral and cross-genre collaboration. So CreateHK will play a leading and coordinating role. We want to encourage diversified and unique creative projects to scale so that Hong Kong's popular culture can scale new heights and go global. This can promote arts and culture, sports and tourism, and their commercialization. And in November 2022, two initiatives were announced under the Film Development Fund. They are Hong Kong Asian Film Collaboration Funding Scheme and the Content Development Scheme for Streaming Platforms. This will encourage Hong Kong's production team to collaborate on productions with other Asian teams and for cross-sectoral production teams on streaming platforms. For Create Smart Initiative, we want to extend the support so that local television stations can collaborate with their mainland or Asian counterparts in the production of variety program. In the future, we want to continue our collaboration with the Hong Kong Design Center in the Sanctuary Pole in, and we will continue to work with the Hong Kong Trade Development Council so that we can expand our market for the creative industry. And currently, we still have $400 million unused for the fund, and we will apply for injection when it is necessary. Thank you. Will Dr. Joseph Wong brief us on the work development of the Hong Kong Design Center? Thank you. Thank you, Chair, members. Now, work report Hong Kong Design Center 2021 to 2022. The core missions are to undertake publicity and promotion of Hong Kong's design works. In the pandemic, the Design Center has organized overseas exchange programs, Knowledge of Design Week and Business of Design Week. And we have allow audiences overseas and locally to appreciate our design, and there are online discussion forums. And with the fashion design online, in the GBA and Shanghai, we had organized physical exhibitions. And second, promotion on design leadership theme on global design reset. The Business of Design Week 2021 had over 80 local and overseas speakers to share their insights. Programs were conducted in a hybrid format, and they were broadcast on primetime television, attracting a global audience of over 840,000. As for the 2022 edition, the theme was Design for Change. Our strategic partner was the Netherlands and Creative NL. And we have gathered over 90 creative leaders around the world to discuss the trends, and we have invited them to Hong Kong. And there were more than 2,500 persons taking part in the summit in person, and over 1 million views for live broadcasting. As for knowledge of design week 2021, the theme was reimagining surface economy. 10 panel sessions, 8 virtual and in-person workshops were organized. Participants came from all over the world. There was a viewership of over 370,000 from all over the world. As for the 2022 edition, the strategic partners was Dutch Design Week and Creative NL. The theme was Regeneration by Design and has a global viewership of over 450,000. As for BODW Plus rollout in October 2021, it has received multiple awards. Third, promotion of design excellence. There were 5 major programs under the DFA awards. Give recognition to the outstanding achievement of design projects, designers, companies, and business leaders. And we had organized in-person exhibition and targeting different markets, including mainland Hong Kong, Taiwan, Japan, Korea, and other Southeast Asian countries. We have hosted 13 online design dialogues. And in 2021, we have received 1,000 entries from 17 and 23 economies respectively. And in 2021, out of the 180 awards, 41 were awarded to local designers. As for DFA HKYDTA, 14 and 13 winners were granted financial support from CreateHK, Hong Kong Polytechnic University, and the Hong Kong Design Institute. In October 2021, we have organized an experience sharing session. In 2021 to 22, in collaboration with the Urban Renewal Authority, we have continued to implement the design initiative of Design Spectrum at 7 Mallory Street. We have 4 major thematic exhibitions and virtual exhibitions to allow the public to view the exhibition during the pandemic. We have attracted some 320,000 visits. Over 90 local design brands were available. After moving out from Mallory Street in August 2022, Design Spectrum presented a design exhibition titled Always at the Central Market and PMQ in Succession. It focused on exploring the sustainable development of Hong Kong and display over 50 design projects. Fourth, nurturing of design entrepreneurs. Design Incubation Program offers financial assistance and incubation services to design startups over a 2-year incubation period. With 344 companies, including 81 under Phase 4. And the companies have received 186 international awards, 333 local awards with 8 patents, 62 registered designs, and created 1,659 job opportunities.
In the support of development of Hong Kong's fashion design industry, we have Fashion Asia Hong Kong 2021. It is held physically and on the virtual platform. This has shown 10 Asian outstanding designers showcasing their work. And in terms of Hong Kong showroom and pop-up spaces, it is used to showcase local emerging design units and graduates as well as students. In relation of Fashion Asia Hong Kong 2022, we will continue to organize activities to promote our ideas. We'll also continue with the 10 Asian Design to Watch exhibition. For the first time, we will work with known local brands and in their Causeway Bay flagship organized exhibitions. And in 2023 and 2024, we will continue to work with local retailers to organize the 10 Asian Designs to Watch exhibition. And in March this year, we will work with famous galleries on the mainland to organize a roving exhibition. We'll continue to nurture local talents and provide expert guidance and support to startups. As at September end of 2020, we have registered three companies. For the two phases, we have garnered 19 international awards as well as about 40 local brands. In relation to Shamshepo design and fashion projects, we have already started design work in 2021. We have organized several rounds of consultation to talk to community members from Shamshepo, design sector, fashion and textile industries, young designers, curators. It is scheduled for completion in 2024. We have spent 20 minutes on presentation. We can see the information on the last slide. Perhaps I will open the floor for members to ask questions. So far, there are seven members. 3 minutes question and answers included. We have Mr. Sunny Tan, Mr. Lam Chan Sing, Mr. Duncan Chiu, Ms. Elizabeth Kwok, Mr. Dennis Leung, I myself, and Mr. Kenneth Fogg. We will start with Mr. Sunny Tan. 3 minutes. There are three areas I'd like to hear some answers. First, in relation to fashion designers, you know that it is a vehicle that's cross-cultural and cross-sectoral. There are a number of awards that we have won, but we do need to give them appropriate support so that we can turn the design into a successful business. I know that work has been put into it, but you need to work with the trade and you need to promote cross-sectoral collaboration to ensure success. We know that there are a lot of fashion shows, but we do need to make successful cases. If there are successful cases, then it will attract youngsters to join the trade. In 2018, in the Hong Kong Film Award, there are 10 new youngsters and 10 new actors who wear local brands, but it only occurred one year. I hope that there will be more cross-sectoral cooperation, say for example with the sports sector, with the arts sector. In the operation of the CSI, it's the same every year. Regarding the events, many of them will last for more than 1 year, so they have encountered difficulties. So would you expedite processing of application and would you make some of these initiatives into a standing one? Well, just two questions because there's no time for answers. In answer to the first question, as we have said, that our focus is to promote cross-sectoral collaboration, say for example, that between film and fashion. We will do more in this regard. It's not just fashion. There is a crossover of fashion and ballet. Please speed up. For these projects, it's project by project, but the time is not limited to 1 year. We have given funding to projects that last for 2 or 3 years. So if they need more time, we will not say no or just give them funding for 1 year. Mr. Lam Chan Sing. Thank you. In relation to the design center, it's said that they would support the development of a local design industry. They hope that Hong Kong will become a design center in Asia. In Shamshepo, there is a design project. That project was conceived over a decade ago. In 2017-18, it was mentioned by the government. It's taken too long. We have Textile Training Council. They have organized higher diploma courses on digital fashion. And in 2021, there were only 5 graduates. There are also a number of diploma or certificate courses. There are students, but they have not kept record as to whether the graduates have joined the design industry. So I am concerned that there is inadequate support to the industry and to manpower training. Can we do more work to actually help Hong Kong build into a design center in Asia? Yes, as we've said, we will do more work. Apart from giving more opportunities to budding fashion designers, we will make use of different schemes to show their talent, to give them chances to participate in exhibitions and training, not just design training courses. But if they want to start their businesses, they have to have knowledge as to how to run a business and how to work with others. In Sham Shui Po, there will be a new design center. The focus is on fashion design. It has taken into account the characteristics of Sham Shui Po. We have had buttons, threads, fabrics, businesses in Sham Shui Po, but we're still talking with the sector to see what they need most. That will be our focus of work for the future. Mr. Duncan Chiu. Well, there is a very popular TV series. The location was in Jiangmen. It has given a boost to their tourism industry. But if a TV series or a film is successful, then it will boost the local economy. Say, for example, another film in Hainan. But our current initiatives are rather passive. There are funds for application, but would you consider working with the CEDB to promote Hong Kong under, say, for example, the Hello Hong Kong campaign? Would you work with the Trade Development Council so that we can provide funding support in mainland production so that they will cover Hong Kong in their plot? This would be conducive to promoting Hong Kong as an international city. So apart from passive support, would you take the initiative to offer support for the promotion of Hong Kong? You mentioned about number 7 Mallory Street. I'd like to ask, well, there has been a number of changes in use. What is the utilization rate? I visited it in the afternoon. Footfall was low. I'll quickly go over 7 Mallory Street. It's a project under the Urban Renewal Authority. After we have left the venue, we don't have any information about the current use. To answer your first question, under the Film Development Fund, our main focus is the promotion of the development of the entire industry. So we encourage first-time directors, and we also encourage people to start their script writing projects. In relation to the promotion of tourist attractions in Hong Kong, perhaps it will be our next stage of work. Say, under Hello Hong Kong campaign, and under the Tourism Board, if we want to promote certain aspects of Hong Kong, whether we want to include it in the film, well, we will think about it. But for the Film Development Fund, it is to promote the local film industry. And if there are overseas projects coming to Hong Kong for our location, we will provide support as much as possible to make sure that the shooting will be as smooth as possible. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Kwok.
Thank you. The creative industry is Hong Kong's soft power. We have done quite well in the past. Let's say for jewelry design, Hong Kong has been doing well. And this has helped in the promotion of the Hong Kong brand globally. So how are we going to enhance our soft power? I think this is something for you to think about, Secretary. Well, there was a variety program where a Hong Kong TV station collaborated with its mainland counterpart. This has revived Cantonese pop songs' popularity in the mainland. These are some very nice programs. And in your opening remarks, you have talked about supporting local TV stations to produce variety shows with their mainland counterparts. I think other than reality shows, perhaps we can think about movies and drama as well. But just then, a fellow member mentioned the popularity of Jiang Men shot up after that movie. But there have been plenty of examples. Hong Kong remains a very popular tourist attraction for Chinese people worldwide. Perhaps you can take the initiative of recruiting or promoting Hong Kong as the backdrop of their movies to mainland movie producers. I believe that this will work wonders in promoting Hong Kong. As for supporting local designs to enter mainland markets, I think we can start from the GBA. I hope that you can do more in these areas. Thank you. We will step up our efforts in these aspects, especially for movie and TV production, through interaction with our mainland counterparts, because there are many collaboration in this regard. I'm sorry, time is up. Well, perhaps you can ask your question and I'll ask the secretary to supply the answer later. Well, for mainland production teams, perhaps they are not aware that we want to collaborate with them. Yes, we will do it proactively. Thank you. Next, Mr. Dennis Leung. Thank you. I'm particularly concerned about paragraph 46 to 47 in the paper, the Shamshapo Design and Fashion Project. Well, together with two trade unions, we have discussed the development of this project. The fabric market has been moved to another area. In the past, the initiative was led by the CEDB, but now it is under the purview of CSTB. This issue first arose in 2009. At the time, the plan was put on hold. The result is that there is a lack of talent in the textile industry. Well, now for the Hong Kong Polytechnic University, the Department of Textile and Fashion Design has been upgraded as a faculty. Now many students are studying design, and yet they have no idea how to actually sew a garment, how to actually produce a product. So for the vocational and professional training, how are you going to collaborate with the EDB? Like I said, we have to formulate a plan as soon as possible. Otherwise, when July, August comes, we have to wait for another year. So how are you going to formulate curriculum or training in collaboration with other bureaus? Thank you. For CSTB or CreateHK, we are mainly focused on fashion design. Of course, there are many elements in the fashion design industry where we require different talents performing different duties in the process. As for whether or not a fashion designer knows how to actually sew a garment, well, different people may have different standards. I think that this warrants further discussion with the industry. If we want to enrich their knowledge in this regard, then we need to reach out to organizations providing training, because this involves what kind of skills are required when we nurture fashion talents. But for the needs or demands, we need to relay your views to the relevant bureaus for further consideration. Next, Mr. Kenneth Fogg. Thank you. Two areas. First, the publishing sector. In the report, I've seen some different publishing events, but I think that we need to support the publishing sector in upgrading and transforming their skills. We need to review the long-term development of our publishing sector. 23rd of April is the World Reading Day. And we want to promote a good reading environment for our citizens. I hope that you can actively consider this. Third question. Using Hong Kong as a backdrop of a movie, well, for production crews to apply for government premises to film a movie, actually now the current process is quite complicated. And to explore, and to build audiences, is it possible to collaborate with schools so that we can foster a culture of watching movies in cinemas? And other than the mainland market, Southeast Asia is also a ripe market for Hong Kong movies. So perhaps Hong Kong ETOs in those areas can step up their efforts in the promotion of Hong Kong movies. Printing and publishing is also part of our creative industry, and we have put in efforts in this regard. And in the past, we have launched campaigns promoting reading in schools and in the community. We have set a direction, and this will remain unchanged. And whether or not we need to set that day as a reading day for the territory, well, this warrants further discussion. As for streamlining the process of applying or renting government premises for film production, I need to look into that. Well, now young people may have a different lifestyle, but we want them to watch different types of movies, be it Hong Kong movies or overseas movies. Through watching different movies, they will be able to learn more about our world, and we will certainly liaise with our mainland offices to promote Hong Kong movies. Thank you. Well, on page 25, Film Development Fund. In how many years, how many applications were made, and how much money was approved? But what is the cost effectiveness? Can you supply us with the answers later? Well, there are 308 movies approved and 42 movies approved in 2021 to 2022. So that means $5 million per movie. And for 816 million, that means 2 million each movie. Well, before we mentioned A Guilty Conscience, the box office was doing well. So how much money are we talking about? You don't have to give me an answer right now. And as for page 9, in 2021, 180 awards, and 41 of them were for local designers, and for 2022, 119 awards, and 49 of which were to local designers. Well, I would like to know what are the actual economic results. I understand that we can't see the results immediately, but how can we keep track of these results? Are there any indicators so that it is easier to follow up? Lastly, I'm sure that many members here would like to see some concrete results. Is it possible for you to invite our members to some of these activities so that in the process of approval, it will make the process easier for us? Well, perhaps I'll respond to your last question first. We'll be delighted to invite members to come to our events. Don't worry, we are quite free. As for the second question, for the Film Development Fund, we can provide some numbers. Well, for each project, how much money did we receive? But actually, our goal was not to receive a bonus from them. Our goal was to support them in their screenplay production. As for the awards received by the Hong Kong Design Center, it is very difficult to separate the results gain. We have to look at it over a longer period of time. Thank you, Secretary. Let's work hard together. Of course, the more the merrier. AOB, if there is none, then meeting adjourned. Thank you.